Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship at Coatesville. This time last week, we could not have foreseen where we would be this time this week. So thank you to all those who have heeded the message to join by Zoom, and thank you to those that are in the chapel and have spread themselves out. Worship has been planned this week in many guises and many ways. The service is primarily planned by Graham, and the worship team have taken over from him when he fell sick. There is perhaps a few loose ends, but we know of a God of grace that meets us at our point of need, and we know that God is with us today. We also know that we have a congregation here that accepts the best people, the best efforts of the people who stand up the front here. I know that from past experience. So today's worship will be led by Lynn Cowan and myself. There will be a few actors in the drama, Kelsey and Sharon as well, and there are a host of other people behind the scenes. Some of those have been working from their homes to get worship ready for you, but we pray that as we gather today for worship, that hearts and minds will be open in whichever forum we're in to hear the word that's been prepared for us. So over to Lynn.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Janet, and the rest of the leadership team for all the hard work you've put in to bring this service to fruition. Now, when you're feeling a bit down, singing is always a really good remedy for that. So perhaps we'll go straight to our first hymn, As the Deer Pants for Living Water. As we usually do, we acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land where we gather and broadcast today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. We pay our respects to the elders, past, present, and emerging, and pledge our ongoing commitment to reconciliation and justice for First Peoples and others in this land. We meet in the presence of God, who creates us in love, redeems us through faith, and sustains us with hope. We come with joy and we come with sorrow, sad at our failings, grateful for God's acceptance. May we know God with us as we join in worship. Let us pray. Lord, as we come to worship, help us to do so with humility. Help us to see ourselves as we are, and remember before you that we are weak without your power, lost without your guidance. Nothing without you, but with you, all things are possible. Amen. Now the reading, the Bible, gospel reading this morning is the parable that Jesus told about two men who went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee who was very up himself, full of pride about how he had been behaving. And the other was a tax collector who came very sorry for the things that he had been doing. And so we have this contrast between pride and humility, and that sets the theme for this service through both the hymns and the prayers and the service and the sermon, sorry. So we come now to our next hymn, which is Come As You Are.
Come as you are, that's how I want you. Come as you are, feel quite at home. Close to my heart, loved and forgiven. Come as you are, why stand alone? No need to fear, love sets no limits. No need to fear. Rest in my love, trust me again. I came to call sinners, not just the righteous. I came to be priest, not to condemn. Each of you failed to live by my promise. Why do you think I'd love you the less? Come as you are, that's how I love you. Come as you are, trust me again. Nothing can change the love that I give you. All will be well, just come as you are.
We come now to God with our prayer of confession. Lord, we are sorry when we have considered ourselves in any way superior to others you have made. Forgive us when pride becomes the centerpiece of our lives, and open our eyes to see where this is a danger. We repent of our assumptions and tendencies to claim the moral high ground, to judge rather than to love, to use our words as ways to trample on others' worth. Forgive us and restore us, for in puffing ourselves up, we let your people down. In Jesus' name, restore us. Amen. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved, for Christ has promised that those who humble themselves and cry out to the Lord for mercy will be justified. Sisters and brothers, hear the words of grace. Your sins are forgiven. And we turn to our next hymn, And Can It Be?
Thanks, Lynn. As we move into hearing the word today, our early message, because we don't have Charlie online, is actually for the adults gathered today. So we're actually, you actually heard from Lynn about the parable that we're going to hear today about our own righteousness and putting God first in that. So we actually have a sketch today, a video clip that James is going to show us in a moment. It's called The Frost Report is Back, and it's about class, but it will give us a bit of a starting point from thinking about those times that we might think that we are better than others. So thanks, James.
I look down on him because I am upper class. I look up to him because he is upper class. But I look down on him because he is lower class. I am middle class. I know my place. I look up to them both. But I don't look up to him as much as I look up to him. Because he has got innate breeding.
I have got innate breeding, but I have not got any money. So sometimes I look up to him.
I still look up to him, because although I have money, I am vulgar. But I'm not as vulgar as him, so I still look down on him. I know my place.
And now across to Lynn for our Bible readings. Well, we might cross to Lynn for our Bible readings. She's on there.
We can hear you, Lynn.
Okay, can you hear me? Is that coming through okay?
Yes, perfect.
Lovely, thank you. The first reading is taken from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 to 8 and 16 to 18, and both readings are from the Good News Translation. As for me, the hour has come for me to be sacrificed. The time is here for me to leave this life. I have done my best in the race. I have run the full distance and I have kept the faith. And now there is waiting for me the victory prize of being put right with God, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but to all those who wait with love for him to appear. No one stood by me the first time I defended myself. All deserted me. May God not count it against them. But the Lord stayed with me and gave me strength so that I was able to proclaim the full message for all the Gentiles to hear. I was rescued from being sentenced to death, and the Lord will rescue me from all evil and take me safely into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. And reading from Luke chapter 18, verses 9 to 14. Jesus also told this parable to people who were sure of their own goodness and despised everybody else. Once there were two men who went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood apart by himself and prayed, "I thank you, God, that I am not greedy, dishonest, or an adulterer like everybody else. I thank you that I am not like that tax collector over there. I fast 2 days a week. I give you 1/10 of all my income." But the tax collector stood at a distance and would not even raise his eyes to heaven and beat on his breast and said, "God, have pity on me, a sinner." "I tell you," said Jesus, the tax collector and not the Pharisee was in the right with God when he went home. For those who make themselves great will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be made great. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And before we have the message, we have a short drama presented to us by Kelsey and Sharon.
Hello? Hello? Is this dialer prayer? Oh, good. Look, I need some help. You'll come over right away? Oh, great. Thanks. Oh, wow. That was quick.
Well, this is only a short drama. What's the problem?
I need to repent.
Why? What have you done? Did you really? Boy, you really do need to repent.
Mm-hmm. So, can you help me?
You've come to the right place. Let's start with our standard model. Now, let's kneel down.
Like this?
That's right. Hands together. How does that feel?
My knees hurt.
No pain, no gain. Now read this.
O almighty, omnipresent one, ye verily I am but a miserable lowly worm, an invertebrate annelid in thine omniscient ocular vision, own obliqueness is manifold. I beseech thee, vouchsafe unto me thine omnipotent expiation.
Now say it louder, like you really mean it.
O almighty, omnipresent one, ye verily I am but a miserable lowly worm, an invertebrate annelid in thine omniscient ocular vision.
Louder.
Mine own obliqueness is manifold, I beseech thee, vouchsafe unto me thine omnipresent. I can't say this, I don't even understand it.
But it's ancient King James English. God loves this sort of stuff.
How do you know?
Well, he's ancient, isn't he? And you only need to do this 2 or 3 or 4 times an hour a day.
4 hours a day.
You want to get God's attention, don't you? And if you really want to impress God, just add the promissory clause.
The promissory clause?
Here.
Lord, if you forgive me, I promise that I'll...
You just have to fill in the blank spaces. But I can see you're not convinced, so perhaps we should move on to the deluxe model.
What's that?
You need to be prostrate.
That sounds like something I should have removed.
No, prostrate, lying down.
But will God take my confession lying down?
Just get down.
Like this?
Lower, face to down on the floor.
It's a bit hard to tell with my face full of carpet.
Yes, people who use this model do tend to vacuum more regularly.
Maybe this model isn't for me. Is there something else I could try?
Well, there is our super deluxe model.
What do I have to do?
First of all, you need to stand up.
I like this one already.
Now, I just need to rip your shirt. What do you think you're doing? Oh, that's you. Sorry.
Why?
Where are we? What do you think you're doing? I'm rendering your clothes. It shows how God, how sorry you are. How does that feel?
Drafty.
Now you need to pull out some of your hair.
Why?
To show how sorry you are.
Like this?
It will have to do. Now, put this on.
What is it?
Sackcloth. It's very biblical. Try beating your chest and looking anguished. That's great. Looks like you're really acting in pain.
I am. You try beating your chest.
And now for the ashes.
Hey, stop that!
I was just finishing off the effect. When God sees this, he'll see you're really sorry.
Look, why do I have to do all this stuff? Why can't I just tell God how sorry I am? And then I want him to forgive me.
Because if that was all it took, then everyone would be doing it.
Gosh. And Sharon thought she didn't like the upfront roles. I think we found a new dramatist. So, let's continue with our message. Oh, and by the way, Kelsey was planning to wash her hair tonight. We'll turn Kelsey grey in an instant. So today's message is actually written by Graham. I'm just delivering it. It's a very direct, plain-speaking beginning. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. It's a very direct and plain speaking challenge to each of us who hear the story now. To that part of us that is comfortable with God because we've been to church, said our prayers, given some money, kept ourselves clean, law-abiding and upright. To that part of us that sees a drunk or a druggie or a prostitute or a thief and feels superiority or perhaps contempt rather than compassion. The parable was to some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else. The parable is good for each of us who have enough faith and courage to honestly recognize our pride and our prejudice. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One, a Pharisee, the other, a tax collector. Pharisees were known to be good, strong men, part of a religious renewal movement. Get back to the scriptures and live holy lives. People that you looked up to for their commitment and devotion and single-mindedness. The law is the law and must be followed in its totality, down to the most minute letter of the law. Jesus loved the law of Moses, and he lived by it. He had some good contact with the Pharisees, but also his most strident criticism is levelled at the Pharisees, sometimes directly to their faces, sometimes indirectly to them, and sometimes indirectly in parables like this one. One of the key things is implied in this verse. The Pharisee stood up and prayed about himself. Other translations of this phrase are even more scathing. The Pharisee stood up and prayed to himself. Whatever was intended in the original, it's clear that the Pharisee's prayer is self-centered rather than centered on God. But this is not just about a particular group of hardline religious fanatics. It's about the human tendency to justify yourself by what you do, to think that you can win God's favour, even manipulate God's favour by your own holiness, particularly in comparison to the unholy, the unclean, the immoral, the wicked, and in the process exalt yourself and prevent God from lifting you. You puff yourself up and prevent God from filling you. You replace God so that your hope is in your own goodness and performance rather than in God's love and forgiveness. Your hope is in self-righteousness rather than in God's grace. There are all sorts of ways in which we do it. Even the very best things that we can do can become self-righteous if our actions become the centre rather than God's mercies in the situations. Even a wonderful sermon illuminating the whole congregation to the dangers of self-righteousness can become a stumbling block for a preacher who thanks God for how good I am. I'm not sure whether that's aimed at Graham or me. Instead of thanking and praising God for how good God is. Our skit worked with the example of prayer. The dial-a-prayer person knew only of the self-centered prayer. The different options for doing the right or holy or successful prayer. She missed the reality of a person who was ready to turn to God. A person who was low and looking for God to uplift. Yep. A person who was empty and looking for God to fill him. A person who was ready to be put right with God by God. The dial-a-prayer person could only keep her focused on herself and ask for forgiveness. Because if that's all it took, then everyone would be doing it. God's will is for everyone to do. It's easy to slip into self-righteousness by making God's simple way more complicated and more about us than God. When God is at the centre, then God's way is simple and uncomplicated, particularly for those with least to give up. Nothing is wrong with a prayer on the knees or prostrate with hands held like this or with long words if they help us love God. But there are problems if our focus is on our own worthiness because of what we do, which leads to self-righteousness. God is a God of love and grace. The good news out of all of this is that God in Jesus justifies you as you are. Thanks be to God. And our song is a new one, but to a familiar tune. A Pharisee Was Praying. Let's pray. Holy mystery, we name God, just and faithful. Bless the offering of our lives and these symbols we offer today. May we help those who cry to you for justice. Amen. I might be up the front, but I also get to do notices. So, we have a stained glass window. The top half of the large window in front of the Scots Church in Collins Street, which was installed in December 1876, just a while ago. From the left, the stories are depicted as such. They are Christ preaching to the multitude from the ship, Christ rebuking the Pharisees. That fits with today, doesn't it? Christ at meat in the Pharisees' house, and Christ weeping over Jerusalem. On with our birthdays, we have a birthday of somebody in the chapel. So happy birthday to James for today. Happy birthday to Lynn Davis on the 28th, and we have one on the 31st for Steve Parkinson. And seeing James is here, we can actually sing happy birthday. Hope you have a lovely day today, James, and to those other people celebrating their birthday during the week, we hope you have a nice day too. On with our notices. A few things have changed this week. There was supposed to be a concert this afternoon, but I think most of you will have got the message today that Songs of Inspiration has been cancelled. Stay tuned for a new date that will come out soon when they've had a chance to work out a new date with the other congregations around us as well. Graham may be sick this week, the week that we've just had, but Graham is also on leave for this coming week. So if there are any problems in the congregation, please feel free to contact one of the leaders, preferably one of the ones as well. And we will manage that as we can. UCAF meets this Wednesday at 1:30 for card making, so please bring a ruler and a pencil and scissors. Some days are better than others, but we've known that for a while. So prayers for Lorna and her three children as we address the new issues of life and getting older. For Lorna, Lord hear us. Anyone else in the chapel? We can. No, I think so. I think we can move on with our prayers of the people, and Lynn will bring us our prayers of the people.
Lynn, you're good to go if you're there.
Thank you. Let us pray. God of compassion, we pray for all those in our congregation who need your special care. For the family of Betty Meehan, who died on Friday. For Chris, her son, and all the family as they mourn her passing. For Pat and Jeff Rogers, Don and Joyce Raymond as they manage at home. Alma at home, recovering from her time in hospital, and Cass Ford, recovering from pneumonia. We pray you will be with the select band recovering from COVID, our loved minister Graham, Cheryl, Jeff and their son David, visiting from Western Australia, Jean Goff and her daughter Wynne, Richard, Don and Gwyneth, and any other church members affected, and people everywhere recovering from COVID. Be with Joy at home as well. We give thanks that Gwyneth and Bob's home has been sold and they can plan on a new future direction for their lives. We pray for Corinne and Lauren together enjoying travel in Italy. And we rejoice that Bill Morgan has reached his 107th birthday. And we thank James celebrating his birthday today and running the service so efficiently for us to join in Zoom or face-to-face at the church. We pray for Mandy, and may the wedding go well for the happy couple who marry this week. Heavenly Father, be with all those working in hospitals, in aged care, in homes and in the community as they support the sick and the frail, often working long and tiring shifts. Be with them as they go home to care for their own families. When they feel tired and burnt out, give them the strength to carry on. We thank you for the army of volunteers, the Defence Force and SES members throughout Australia as they work to assist all those affected by the flooding. Be with those in evacuation shelters and those supporting them with bedding, clothing and warm meals until it is safe for them to go home. We thank you for the community support in flooded areas, from school children to the elderly, filling sandbags and protecting homes and businesses. Be with Lauren and her neighbours and the pets and livestock and dairy farmers as they struggle to milk their cows. Be with all those returning to flood damaged property. Be with those without power and those cut off with water over roads. Loving God, we pray for families caught up in domestic violence. May adults try to resolve issues and shield their children from harm. We ask your care for children separated from parents and parents separated from children. Heal and ease their pain. We pray for those suffering from depression and poor mental health. We pray for those driven to self-harm and desperation. Be with students as they sit end-of-year exams, especially those trying to stay focused while living in flood-affected and damaged homes. Be with us all as we deal with the issues important to us as we go about our everyday lives. We thank you for the musicians in our church and the members who prepare services to look forward to each week. All these things we ask in your name. Amen.
Our final hymn today is I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. Hand will sing. closing and benediction, I'd just like to say thank you to anyone who has had any part in preparing this week's service. It has been a bit of a jumble from woe to go, but we put the jigsaw puzzle pieces together, and I hope you've managed to worship well and touch hearts with God. Let's move into our benediction. Go now, rejoicing in the Lord your God. Fight the good fight, finish the race, keep the faith. And may God rescue you from every evil attack. May Christ Jesus reserve for you the crown of righteousness. And may the Holy Spirit flood you with grace and overflow in you with visions and dreams of glory. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen. And I guess we'll...